Well, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to my talk. My name is Rens de Vries, and today I'm going to talk a bit about having some fun using some robotic stuff, combining that with some microservices, running on Docker that is deployed on a Kubernetes cluster. And today I'm really hoping to inspire everyone. It's not so much about a deep dive, it's more about showing you what kind of cool things you can do if you hack a bit and put some things together. And hopefully inspire everyone here to start experimenting a bit with these technologies. So today I want to talk actually about two robots in particular, and that's what we're going to have some fun with. First of all, is an Alderburn Now robot. And I actually have a real one at home, but due to logistical reasons, I could not bring it. It's a bit heavy, unfortunately. So we'll have to make do with the simulated version today. Basically, it's a humanoid robot. The one in the picture here, actually, it has 25 degrees of freedom, and it has multiple sensors, from cameras to sensors that detect obstacles, basically. And the second robot is the one that I did bring. It's something I completely built myself, which is basically a robotic arm built out of 7 servos run by a Raspberry Pi 2. And basically, what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to connect these two robots, basically. So, and how I'm going to do that is I'm going to control these robots using some microservices, which are going to orchestrate and connect all these robots together. And all these microservices running as Docker containers on top of a Kubernetes cluster. And I will show you a bit about how you can do that, basically. And why do I want to do that? Why am I so fascinated by it? Well, one, it's an experimentation platform for me. So I experiment with the latest technologies using this setup. But also very important is that the problem with robotics is that capacity for sort of amateuristic robotics is very limited. I mean, this is a Raspberry Pi 2. We all have seen it. It's very limited in terms of compute power. If you want to do something with artificial intelligence, or like this morning was demonstrated about using something like IBM Watson, yeah, you cannot run that on a Raspberry Pi, basically. So you want to be able to run that on the cloud. And that's really what I want to demonstrate, is that by using these microservices on Docker and Kubernetes, you can very easily run this in the cloud and still do the basic control of your robot on the local device. And this offers also things like remote control possibilities, where someone is sitting in a data center controlling a robot on long distance connected via the cloud. And ultimately, yeah, perhaps this could be the next Skynet, who knows? So how we're going to do that today, I'm going to deploy a number of microservices. And it's very important I have two robots. And the robots are basically on the right side of the picture. And both of these robots have a bit of Java controller software. This is really a very, very dumb controller software that does nothing else than basically if a servo has moved here. So if I were to move it here, it gives a state update. It says something has changed. The position of the servo has changed. It creates a universal message, and that message is forwarded to MQTT, which is sort of an Internet of Things messaging broker pub/sub protocol, basically. And for both the Now robot and the Raspberry Pi robot, I basically have this Java controller software that for the servos and for the sensors forwards state information to MQTT, but also very important, it listens to commands, specifically commands given to that particular robot. So I can give, for example, this robot a command to move the arm or run an animation or something like that. All the way in the left-hand side of the picture, I have this draw this robot client. This is actually where I'm going to do a bit of the magic, because I want to connect these two robots to each other, and this robot client is the one that's going to do it. He knows that both robots exist, and he has this state service where he gets information about the servo, the position, and the sensors. So it's a WebSocket-based REST service. He constantly gets updates of all the robots that are connected to this cloud. And he can send commands to this command service. It's again a very simple REST command service, which is just sending simple JSON messages, basically saying, go and run this animation, or go and move this servo, basically. Now, there's a bit of internal glue there. There is an edge processor that goes from the MQTT to the internal network. Why I do that? Because I want to filter out unauthorized messages, basically. Not anyone can connect to this MQTT endpoint. And even if they do manage to, I want to do a sanity check. So there's not anyone that can connect or connect these robots to each other. The glue really lies on the left-hand side. These robots are very dumb and only connect to MQTT in an isolated channel. So this edge processor connects it to the internal network. There's ActiveMQ that accesses a message router, basically. And there's Cassandra that stores the state, basically, so that I can actually constantly ask what is the latest state of the robot, basically. So this is what I'm going to deploy. And all these containers are going to deploy as Docker containers. All of these microservices or services are built on Spring Boot. Things like ActiveMQ and MQTT, they have some out-of-the-box Docker containers already available. They're based on REST in this particular case. I will deploy two messaging containers, the MQTT one and ActiveMQ. And I will also deploy Cassandra against my cluster, basically. Now actually the fun part, basically, because anyone can deploy a Docker container these days. It's very simple. There's actually no fun. It's just simple command and it's there. The problem comes if you're going to have multiple containers, because if I have, in my case, like six containers have to deploy, they need to be aware what is their location, what is their IP address. You don't want to really glue and code that in scripts. Now, that's really where Kubernetes comes in. It offers a bit of container orchestration. And really the neat part about is that Kubernetes introduces a number of concepts. So it introduces a concept like a deployment object that gives an instruction to Kubernetes saying, I want you to deploy this container with this kind of rule set, meaning a minimum amount of containers and a maximum amount of containers. And this rule set is defined in something what we call a replica set. And that basically means that in any given time, Kubernetes ensures that that's the minimum and maximum amount of containers that runs at a particular time. The pods, those are in essence the actual containers or a set of containers running on the single node, basically inside the cluster. And then very important, that is actually, I think, what really makes Kubernetes great, at least for me, is the services concept. Because if you deploy a container in Kubernetes, it's actually by default not exposed. For that, you introduce something called a server. So you say, if I have my ActiveMQ Docker container I've deployed, and you want to make it available to other containers, you have to define a server that says, this ActiveMQ installation is now available on a certain port. These services in certain cloud vendors translate into load balancers if you want them to be publicly available. But if you just want it to be an internal service, it allows you to just internally address it. But also the nice thing about it is that basically it allows you to directly connect to a DNS name and not have to have an IP address. So internally, my ActiveMQ only knows AMQ, the name of the service, basically. And it's also supported on all the major cloud vendors, so AWS, Azure, and Google Cloud. Google Cloud is really the best one because it's native integration. So today I'm going to demonstrate this using Minikube, which is a local deployment version of Kubernetes that I can run on my laptop. And I can use it and run it against something like VirtualBox, X5, Hyper-V, etc. And it will run a single node Kubernetes cluster on my laptop, basically. And that contains both the orchestration software, which is called the master, and the minion, which is the worker, which deploys the containers themselves. The downside is because it's a local deployment, I cannot use load balancers. It's just not available in Minikube. So it uses something called a null port, meaning it explicitly exposes certain ports. So I have to bind to that port. So that means that I have to do a bit of extra glue, basically. And very last one, and I think this is really a recent one in the last 6 months has been really upcoming, is Kubernetes Helm, which is sort of a package manager for Kubernetes. Because what's very difficult is you have six containers and services to deploy is that I've typed that six times on my command line or have some automated job for it. But still, I cannot sort of like combine them in one go. But that's actually really what I want because they're sort of a joint set, basically. So that's where the package manager comes in. There where you define something called charts, which sort of are packages of a set of deployment objects. And in one go, you deploy a chart against the Kubernetes cluster, and it will deploy all the deployment objects and then the related containers and services in one go. And they have an own lifecycle. So basically, it has its own version management. And there's even official repositories like Maven Central and that sort of stuff basically available. So it's kind of neat. And I think this will really take off. And in the end, it will allow you to very quickly deploy applications against your Kubernetes cluster. So let's do a demo. And I actually want to deploy it. So what I'm going to deploy is using Kubernetes Helm, all these core services and their dependencies. And I'm not going to deploy two demo containers. The first demo container is going to trigger an animation in the robot arm that I have here with me. And the second one is going to allow me to remote control a simulated Now robot using this arm. So let's get to it, basically. So first of all, I'm running Minikube on my laptop, basically. And you see at this moment, there's no containers, nothing deployed. So I want to get this started very quickly. And basically what I have here is on my command line, I have this robotics TGZ package. It is basically a Helm package that I want to install. So what I do is simply Helm install robotics.tgc. So what happens very quickly, it's already deployed it. It has created an installation name for it, so I can also in one go delete or update it basically, and it has deployed all my deployment objects, replica sets, and containers. So if I refresh it now, we see that all of them now available instantly. Now, so they are starting up, and you see also that the ARM is now already basically activated. So before it was in a sort of a dormant state, on the moment it could connect to MQTT, it triggered an animation to go to its starting position basically. So the first thing I want to do is I want to trigger that animation. So what I'm going to show you guys is this very simple Docker Spring Boot application that I deploy as a Docker container, which basically what it will do, this is my robotic SDK that connects to MQTT. So it's not important too much, but what's very important is it runs this animation called animation one. And after 30 seconds, it will stop the animation basically. So now I want to deploy this. And we're going to deploy this using simple the command line from Kubernetes, or kubectl. So I do kubectl create minus f, and this one is called demo one. What will happen is that as soon as it's active, there will be an animation triggered in this robot if everything goes well. So that's great, it worked. So let's check the dashboard. Now the dashboard, you see now also that there's a deployment object here, demo one, and that has a replica set. And on the replica set, there's one pod active, basically. View the log files if I want to here. Basically, after 30 seconds, it will just kill itself, basically. And if I want to re-trigger the animation after it has killed itself, I basically could just simply delete the pod, basically. So stop the animation now at this moment. So let's delete the pod. And what you will see happen is that the replica set has triggered immediately a new pod to be created. Here for, it's active for 3 seconds. And now it restarts the animation at this moment. So the second demo I want to show is basically one where I can actually do remote control. So basically the second container, also Spring Boot application, defines two robots. One is Max, which is the robot arm, and the other one is Pep, which is the now robot. And what I will do on startup, I will run an animation called arm control, which will put it in a sort of a joystick-like mode. After 10 seconds, it will disable 3 of the servos, so I can move it freely, and then the feedback from that will be listened towards. And based on that feedback, I will move a now robot, basically, which is running here, basically. Yeah. So let me do that. So let's deploy the container. And the first thing we should see is that it will move into a different position, basically. So it's doing that. So then let's go here. So I've built in a small cheat because I don't want to run have the robot go haywire when I'm at home with the real one. So I have to first open its hand basically before I'm allowed to walk it. So if I here open the hand in the animation, you should see it also opens its hands there basically and it closes them. So, and then if I move it forward, move it forward. Still alpha software, so see, it will actually move forward basically. And that is actually done by the Docker container itself. So it's not run on the Java controller software in the robot. It's really running inside the Docker container that's deployed on my Kubernetes cluster. So if I stop it, I put it just back to the middle. I close the hands. And basically I can do whatever I want here and it will not trigger an action anymore because this is just what the Docker container has deployed as behavior basically. So that's sort of the demo, and what I wanted to really achieve with this is that you guys see a bit of the coolness on how quickly you can get up and running using Kubernetes. Use Minikube to test out things locally on your laptop. Use Kubernetes Helm as a package manager to very quickly install complex applications. And in the end, yeah, also show and demonstrate how cool and quick you can actually connect these kind of robots to the cloud, basically. So all the resources you can find on my blog, so rensdevries.wordpress.com. All of this stuff is also described in that blog file, in the blog, and you can read a bit on more stuff in more detail on what I've done. There's also a link to sources on my blog post, basically. So that's it. I hope you guys have a bit of inspiration and start using it yourself. So thank you.